Okay, thanks very much for inviting me. I should just quickly start by saying that I'm a geographer and also an urbanist. And I'm also, at the moment, trying to get increasingly involved in urban field ecology as well, and sort of branching out in different directions. My primary research interests really revolve around infrastructure, landscape, and increasingly the field of biodiversity as well. Actually, could we keep the lights down at the front, thanks? Yeah. So today then I want to outline some current work that I'm doing towards a book project. And the subject of water is something that I've been working on for a few years now. And to some extent, it's seems deceptively simple. So you have philosophers such as Gaston Bachelard making these, in a sense, kind of sort of sweeping philosophical generalizations around water, a very influential body of work. But when you actually probe deeper into some of the, what appear to be sort of a common sense, universalist conceptions of water, things become much more complicated. So I've read some interesting feminist critiques of Bachelard, who showed that his particular use of language, and in particular his association between gender and language, the fact that in the French language water is a feminine noun, and in his philosophical treatise, he suggests there's some kind of innate sets of essentialist relationships between language, gender, nature. Immediately, you're thrown into a set of problematics, I think, concerning the ideology of nature. So water, then, lies at the intersection of landscape and infrastructure, crossing between visible and invisible spheres of urban space. Water forms part of the material culture of modernity, ranging from the private spaces of the home to vast technological networks. And it is also powerfully inscribed in the realm of imagination. Although the transformation of human interaction with water has been a kind of organization or technological focus for the rationalization of urban space, the global experience, as we've heard many times during this conference, remains starkly uneven. So there are five things I want to look at today with you. I want to start by considering water, space, and power. I then want to move on to periodicities, and I'm hoping that this may resonate with some comments that Neil Brenner made in relation to planetary urbanization and trying to historicize these shifts in terms of urban geographies. Thirdly, I want to say something about metabolisms. It seems that urban metabolism is a recurring conceptual trope, and it's something that is ongoing, and I think in many ways extremely interesting to think about what metabolism means in an urban context. I then want to say something under the title of tactics, tubs, and technologies, something about the entanglement between social and technological systems. And then finally, I want to say something about representations and link back to this question of landscape and think through some of these connections between infrastructure and landscape. So, to begin with then, thinking about landscape as infrastructure, it's very striking looking at the example of the LA River, how these two concepts are both closely connected and at the same time very difficult to delineate. So one of the chapters in my book I'm working on is looking at the Los Angeles River and trying to think through these different discourses in relation to the transformation of the river into a concrete drainage channel, and then more recently these emerging discourses in terms of ecology and different approaches to managing water in the city, and trying to think through what these different discourses actually mean. It seems in an intellectual academic sense that the fields of landscape and infrastructure are now intersecting in a very fruitful way. So Pierre Bellanger at the Graduate School of Design at Harvard has written interesting articles on this, particularly in relation to post-industrial landscapes and trying to bring together these disparate fields. But a question then would be, how do these extraordinary built environments get produced? What kinds of circulations are in play here? And I think that the work of Eric Swingerdow really stands out here, particularly in his work in Ecuador and looking at the circulations of commodities and the way capital has flowed into the building of the urban environment and physical networks in the city. And certainly I think the work of Swingerdow builds on earlier work in urban studies concerning circuits of capital and the built form of the city. And these ideas have coalesced around particularly the idea of urban political ecology, which has proved quite an influential body of work, particularly in the 1990s, essentially bringing together aspects of neo-Marxian urban theory with an analysis of urban environmental change and urban environmental issues. Now, thinking about the production of space, something that I think is interesting that stands out to me is the question of axes of visibility. So when we're talking about infrastructure, there's often a tension, if you like, between the visible and the invisible. And one of the peculiarities, perhaps, of cities in the global south is, as the anthropologist Arjuna Pajaray states, everything is fully available to the gaze. So in the work that I was doing in Lagos in Nigeria, it's very apparent that infrastructure is both absent yet present. The so-called spaghettiization effect of these multi-connected pipes and so on, attempts to tap municipal water supplies where they're available, the role of tankers, micro-circuits of exploitation, buckets everywhere. You could almost describe a city such as Lagos as the city of buckets in terms of the efforts to try and store water by every available means. So we have this tension then between the visible and the invisible, and this is expressed globally, I think, in very profound ways. But if we talk about axes of visibility, the emphasis very much then on the horizontal city, but we should not also neglect to think about the vertical axes of visibility. So this is one of the famous illustrations by Edmond Texier, Tableau de Paris, 1852. So what the cross-section through one of the apartment buildings in Paris. But a couple of things that are worth noticing here is that the poor were generally restricted to the upper floors of these buildings, partly because obviously this was the pre-elevator age, and they were also furthest away from sources of water or the convenience of the street. So we have this interesting vertical segregation by social class. And in a contemporary context, my colleague Andrew Harris at UCL has been doing work on vertical urbanisms. And the picture now is perhaps more complicated because, of course, we know about luxury condominium apartments and other sort of vertical divisions of space. But some of these 19th century patterns persist. So in a UK context, for example, a majority of children of Afro-Caribbean origin living in poverty live above the fifth or sixth floors of public housing projects, which Danny Dorling, the geographer, looked at in some of his demographic work. So these vertical axes remain significant and important, I think. Also, thinking about the production of space, the biopolitical dynamics, I mentioned a second ago, the emergence of urban political ecology as an identifiable field of work, linking with neo-Marxian analysis. But it seems to me that the epidemiological dimensions to urban ecology are to some degree underexplored at present. So if we look globally at, for example, dengue fever, we know that the spread of dengue fever, there are several factors involved, but the spread of dengue fever is nonetheless connected to some degree with patterns of urbanisation and the creation of habitats within which the Aedes mosquitoes can flourish. So if we look in Southeast Asia, for example, after the the East Asian economic crisis of the late 90s, abandoned building sites in cities such as Bangkok and Jakarta proved the perfect breeding grounds for the mosquitoes that carry dengue fever. So we have this evolving relationship then between disease and urban space. And these relationships are not, however, restricted to the global south. So in the USA, foreclosures have created a particular geography which is conducive to the spread of insect vectors, particularly through abandoned swimming pools, so that the Culex pipiens insect vector can actually breed in these pools. So there's another kind of geography of disease emerging in relation to foreclosures. And added to that, of course, we should not forget that there are the evolutionary dynamics of these vectors themselves. So we have an immensely complicated set of relationships emerging in relation to urbanization and epidemiology. I want to say something now about periodicities and hopefully linking with the planetary urbanization debate. Historians, or architectural historians, as Siegfried Gideon, have persuasively suggested that how society organizes its water is to some degree a marker of how significant individual well-being is within particular social or political constellations. And he amasses a whole range of interesting data about changes through time. And certainly there have been efforts to identify ideal types in relation to urban infrastructure. Stephen Graham and Simon Marvin's modern infrastructural ideal is one such example, comprising specific ideologies of science, the modern discipline of urban planning, emergent patterns of consumption, and also territorial dimensions to the modern state. And I think this is an interesting thesis. But one of the difficulties, however, with these ideal types is that they invariably have originated within a context of European or North American urbanization, particularly in relation to the challenges of the 19th century city. And one of the current debates is really how these ideal types or phases or periodicities might actually apply to the global south or different urban contexts. I think possibly it's more helpful somehow to think of fractured modernities, the way in which particular models of modernity have been used or translated or partially implemented. So we have a much more fractured or disjointed geography of modernities. And it's interesting perhaps that the middle decades of the 20th century mark the kind of the high water mark for a particular confidence about a kind of teleological model of technology, urbanization, and science. So the historian Mark Mizawa, who's written several fascinating books, one most recently on the history of the United Nations, he talks about the immediate post-war era as one marked by technocratic assurance and also imperial modernism among the different elements in play. And we shouldn't forget that even if we move into the 1950s, late 50s or 1960s, that the universalist ideal of infrastructure provision remained highly uneven, even within the global north. So housing surveys in the late 50s, for example, in Morley in Yorkshire, found that half of the homes lacked a bath and almost a third shared a lavatory. Whilst in the Gorbals district of Glasgow, only one house in 30 had a bath. This is around 1958 to 1959. So we have to be a little bit careful about assuming, if you like, that these models were as widespread as we might have imagined. In the global south, the pattern becomes more complex still. And I just want to say a couple of words about an aspect to the current project I'm writing on, which is to do with malaria control in Lagos, in Nigeria. And one of the interesting features of this attempt to modify the topography of water in the urban environment to protect human health is it was only for geopolitical reasons in the 1940s, this is a malaria control map of the area, it was only for geopolitical reasons in the 1940s because Lagos served as the major military staging post for British forces in North Africa, and something like 90% of personnel were quickly becoming ill when they stopped in the Lagos metropolitan region. So then there was this comprehensive and rapid swamp control program, swamp clearance program was brought into play. So it's interesting in terms of histories of public health and so on that sometimes we can mistakenly think that these massive engineering programs were driven for primarily benevolent purposes rather than more narrow self-interest in this particular case. But then behind this pattern of malaria control in Nigeria, there are yet more complexities. So this is a photograph from the early 40s, which is even the iconography of this image, the partially clothed European helping to survey swamps as part of the clearance scheme. Leonard Bruce Chwat, a Polish malariologist, proved extremely influential in terms of malaria control in Nigeria, and then moved on to take a very senior post within the World Health Organization. So we have these, towards the end of the colonial era and the immediate post-colonial era then, interesting continuities in terms of scientific expertise and bureaucratic personnel between the colonial state and these new international structures of government being formed. And I should just mention that in the Nigerian context, that in the early 60s, there was a real confidence that in the immediate post-colonial era, and a real confidence that malaria would be eliminated in Nigeria and many other sub-Saharan African countries. This has not happened. And recent data suggests that the threat of malaria has worsened in the Lagos metropolitan region, which is partly related to its dysfunctional urban infrastructure, the open drainage system, standing water and so on, lack of availability of primary health care and many other factors. So an immensely complicated and interesting story, I think, in terms of trying to protect human health in relation to urban water topographies. So moving on then to think about metabolism, so this idea of urban metabolism. I think this is a very rich and fascinating area of current work in terms of what the concept can actually mean for cities. And it's really very divergent in terms of potential meanings and applications. So we go back to William Harvey's discovery of the blood circulatory system in the human body in 1628, and then its gradual appropriation as a metaphor for understanding the circulatory dynamics of cities and so on, highly influential in terms of a corporeal metaphor applied to urban space. But then in a sense from the 1980s onwards, in the last couple of decades of the 20th century, a far more complex interpretation of corporeal metaphors, particularly associated with the work of Donna Haraway, who you may not realize it, is also an anime character in Japanese animation, such as her sort of interesting status as a theoretician. With her notion of the cyborg manifesto and how this may be reinterpreted in terms of a cyborg urbanization, which is a critical reinterpretation of the relationship between the body and the city, not based on some of these earlier corporeal metaphors about the holistic or organic unity of the city, not resting on these Cold War metaphors of the space traveler or the astronaut with a technologically enhanced individual body, but rather the relationship between the body and the complex apparatus of the city that enables the human body or human life to flourish in the city. So this complex technological apparatus moving from the cyborg to a more general sense of cyborg urbanization, which I think is very interesting. But I should stress, though, one of the themes that came up in some of the earlier presentations is the persistence of 19th century metaphors and terminology in relation to the contemporary city. And sometimes these are reworked in surprising ways, so that, if you like, the corporeal analogies of the 19th century city have been reworked in the context of the neo-organicist city and the digital realm, the thinking space of the city. As a thinking of the city as the, if you like, the brain rather than the lungs or the heart and so on. So some of these analogies persist. I'm struck, though, that the notion of cyborg urbanization and an expanded conception of the relationship between cities as discrete entities and urbanization more generally, I think links in an interesting ways this notion of planetary urbanization, which we've heard something about, and also, for example, these operational landscapes that Neil Brenner mentioned. I quite like also the term ecological frontiers. So what kind of, linking again perhaps between landscape and infrastructure, what types of landscapes are produced through urbanization beyond the city itself, as we are familiar with? Also, interestingly, in terms of the landscapes of urbanization, this is sort of one of the outer suburbs of Mumbai, Andheri, and these extraordinary landscapes of water pipes, and which are also used, by the way, for pedestrians, the pedestrian walkways. Now, these pipe landscapes, for me, also speak to another interesting conceptual literature, the related concept of technological zones developed by Andrew Barry, because I think Barry combines the material and institutional aspects of the interface between space, society, and nature. And it's interesting, if you look at Barry's work, that he does identify a kind of periodicity to the establishment of these technological zones through things such as standardization, technical compatibilities, regulatory competences, and so on. So we have this really interesting material and institutional landscape that emerges from this idea of technological zones. We also have, I think, in an urban context, if we're talking about zones, what we could perhaps characterize as the terminal edge lands of urbanization, where sometimes the most intense conflict occurs, sometimes referred to as the peri-urban, where we have an interrelated nexus of developments. In the case of Mumbai, there's a relationship between the degradation of rural environments and rural economic crises and how these feed into patterns of urbanization. So in this sense, we can't really separate the rural and the urban. It's an interrelated dynamic that we need to look at and try to understand. And as, again, I think there's immense scope to do interesting work, which I know Roger and others have done, looking away from the more familiar areas or spaces of the city, looking at the edges or expanding zones of the city and trying to think through the dynamics of these changes. And in terms of global urbanization, I mentioned the concept of ecological frontiers or operational landscapes a moment ago. Among the, if you like, the technological fixes to allow an essentially unchanged momentum for urbanization are, for example, nuclear-powered desalination plants to provide water, new sources of energy, fracking, for example, and the implications being, of course, that if these environmentally damaging processes such as fracking become more widespread, then within 10 or 20 years' time, Antarctica would be fair game to almost any kind of exploratory technology. So there are profound issues at stake, I think, in terms of the relations between environmental futures and urban futures, which we need to think about. So the next topic I want to consider is that of tactics, tubs, and technologies, and thinking through some of the relationships between social and technological systems. So one interesting body of work has been the sociologist Norbert Elias, looking at the what he calls the process of civilization, which obviously sounds a slightly pejorative term in the narrow sense in which he's applied this, but he's really drawn together a large range of vignettes or historical fragments, if you like, to try and get a sense of how human behavior and material culture changes over time. And there are many other historians and anthropologists who've done similar types of work. But if we think about changes in terms of the, if you like, the philosophy of the tub or the philosophy of the bath, we can look at interesting examples, which are Albrecht Dürer, Das Frauenbad, 1496. And this drawing by Dürer captures a highly ambiguous moment in European history between pervasive communal bathing which was for pleasure as well as for other reasons, a sort of a social convivial activity, and then a gradual movement towards a much more restrictive code in relation to the human body, and also changing fashions and attitudes towards water. So in fact, in a European context, the extent of bathing declines quite sharply until the 19th century. And gradually we see a new kind of socio-technological constellation begin to emerge, which is connected with the gradual centralization and standardization of technological networks, some of the apparatus that Steve mentioned this morning. The spread of new tastes in architecture, design, and materials, porcelain, for example, and also the rise of a greater corporeal self-consciousness. So historians such as Alain Corbin have written about the, if you like, the retreat from the communal or the convivial to a private corporeal realm, and a greater self-consciousness under the impetus of modernity and the entanglement, if you like, of the social and the technological. Now, the bath, then, is an interesting focal point for some of these studies, and it's interesting because although the bath itself begins to make an appearance, the modern bath, if you like, from the middle of the 19th century, it doesn't really catch on significantly until the late 19th century in relation to hotel architecture and the introduction of hot water as well. So some of these earlier associations with pleasure or relaxation begin to creep back into cultures of bathing. Now, in terms of trying to analyse some of these changes, I think that Patrick Joyce's book, The Rule of Freedom, is interesting in bringing some of the insights of Foucault into play in terms of the patterns of life in the modern city. And the basic argument here by Patrick Joyce, Thomas Osborne and others is that changing patterns of bodily conduct in the modern city were not things that necessarily had to be directly enforced. It was more the mere presence of new new availability of water, modern bathrooms, possibilities for bathing, changing discourses around the body actually led to some degree to a kind of autonomous set of cultural changes through this entanglement again between the social and the technological. Similarly, the German sociologist Elisabeth Heidenreich makes a very similar set of arguments about the spread of technological networks and the associated social and institutional changes that are associated with that change. Now, in terms of water infrastructure, I think one of the interesting shifts is, as we move through the modern era, a shift from, if you like, from facade to function. If you look at some of the 19th century early attempts to build water systems and water architecture, New York's an example, the water works often have these extraordinarily elaborate facades behind which lay a completely inadequate and dysfunctional sort of miniature water system. But this relationship then between, if you like, facade and function begins to shift. And at one point in writing this, I'd wanted to argue perhaps that the aesthetic is downplayed by function. But then reflecting on this, I don't think that's the case. And I just want to show you an example. The Thames Barrier in London, completed in 1982, is probably, arguably, one of the most remarkable pieces of civil engineering of the last 40 or 50 years. It's not only revolutionary in its design, but the story behind it, I think, is extremely interesting. So this sketch here, this diagram here, is from a conference held in 1977 in London, mainly from engineers and so on. And looking through this, the conference proceedings, I was struck by the extraordinary beauty, really, of these diagrams for public engineering architecture. And there's an Italian architectural magazine actually used some of these figures as a kind of as an embellishment to a larger story about water architecture over time. But there's more to this even than that, because the Thames Barrier is an example of public architecture commissioned by the former Greater London Council. And arguably, it was their greatest achievement before they were abolished in 1986. And it was completed in 1982, actually used in 1983 for the first time, exactly 30 years after the flood incident that affected the east of England and also the Netherlands. So there was a 30-year delay between this extraordinary infrastructure installation and the original incident that had sparked this change. But I'm interested, though, about a certain aesthetic, technological logic that associates with these kind of structures. I think there's a very interesting history to be told. And certainly, looking ahead, 20 or 30 years from now, London will again be engaged, undoubtedly, in a very intense discussion about the future of its water infrastructure and what kind of pathway will be taken in relation to possible sea level rise effects. This question of pathways really brings me to the notion of technological politics. And I was really fascinated by the presentation yesterday about the energy politics in Berlin, which also parallels a campaign to take back the water supply as well. And when you look more into this, the more remarkable these developments appear, because these are citizens' initiatives, and to a significant degree, they've been emerging autonomously from established political parties. Even the Green Party or Die Linke has really, up till now, played a very kind of flat-footed kind of catch-up role in trying to respond to what's really going on at grassroots level. And among the various aspects to this new politics of technology in Berlin, and arguably other cities as well, is the demand for information, that these huge 20-year contracts occasionally come up for renewal. That is the moment when the civic sphere can make a critical intervention. But in order to be successful, they need the information, they need the financial information, they need the technical information. And there was years of struggle in Berlin to actually release this information to the public. And eventually there was a successful local referendum in the city when information became available. So for me at least, I think this is a really fascinating field politically. And Armin Collel talked about taking back the city. And this, I think, is quite literally what is happening in relation to some of these technological networks. I mentioned a second ago about potential future political tensions around water within the city. And to return to London for a moment, there is this increasing emphasis on what will happen in the future if London floods, as it's predicted. And there's an architectural collective, Squint Opera, who produced these rather nice digital projections for the year 2090. But I would argue that some of these works are counter-dystopian projections, because in all of these images, everybody seems completely at ease in this new environment. And that, of course, it's a kind of ironic science fiction representation, but it's also questioning some of the inevitable kind of dystopian imaginaries for the future of London. And London will certainly have to make profound decisions between some kind of large-scale technocratic solution, a new barrier that would potentially even dwarf the current Thames barrier, or it could possibly think about radical new socio-ecological arrangements, say, around an expanded floodplain. And this is actually already happening in parts of South London. The River Quaggy, which is a tributary of the Thames in Lewisham, is being sort of ecologically remodeled. I won't use the word restoration, because that's a problematic term, but it's nevertheless it's being remodeled as a kind of public park, simultaneously devoted to enhancing biodiversity, but also making local communities safer from the potential of future flooding. And this presents a really very interesting alternative to some of the other possibilities available. Also, just beyond the eastern fringe of London, Raynham in Essex is currently a nature reserve of international significance. But these sites are also increasingly in the frame in terms of potential eastward expansion of London. The Thames Gateway project, one of the largest publicly backed development projects of any European city being built in areas potentially prone to flooding. And at this moment, it appears it's only really the insurance industry and ecologists who are raising serious questions about whether this is such a good idea for the future of London. In Los Angeles, which I mentioned at the start of this presentation, there's also a lot of interest in restoring the river, but I would like to enter a note of caution, really, about what these discourses of ecological restoration are really about. In this particular image here, it's perhaps difficult to pick out unless you're a trained botanist, but there are perhaps two main, there's a species of bamboo and also a species of willow, which are two of the main plants here, which are in this sort of ecological, spontaneous ecological assemblage here. And I met up with some of the environmentalist groups involved in trying to restore nature to the Los Angeles River. And one of the leading environmentalists took me on a small walk here, and he pointed to these trees, the bamboo and the willow, and he said there's a struggle going on here between darkness and light, between Christianity and Islam. He actually used extraordinary geopolitical analogy to refer to the spontaneous ecology of the Los Angeles River without even a blink. And it occurs to me that there is a profound interconnection between ideology and ecology in relation to ecological restoration in an urban environment, because urban ecologies are of necessity cosmopolitan ecologies. So the attempt to, if you like, reproduce some imaginary earlier ecological assemblage from 1,000 or even 10,000 years earlier has a very specific political undertone, I think, in terms of what is actually being done in relation to urban nature in these kind of sites. So, in a sense, when I started off the work on the LA River, I sort of naively assumed that it was a completely benevolent program of landscape restoration, and pretty soon you find that there are many more complexities here. Plus, there are artists and others who rather like the concrete landscapes I showed you at the start of the presentation. Not everybody agrees with some of these ideas about remodeling nature within the city, and that's to say nothing of the possibilities for so-called ecological gentrification and the way that riverside or waterfront sites have been greatly valorized in terms of recent processes of urban development. So, moving on now to the final kind of broad theme that I want to look at with you. I mentioned at the start of this presentation that I'm interested in landscape as well as infrastructure. And for me, cultural representations of cities can enrich our understanding of historical aspects of urban environmental change beyond the use of maps, plans, reports, and other official sources. And central, I think, to these ideas is going back to art, literature, and other sources, and having another look, and thinking through what kind of spaces, places, or moments are actually being represented here, and how can we use that in combination with existing approaches to interpreting urban change and urban history. So just to give a couple of interesting examples for me concerning what I would describe as interstitial spaces in the city, that is, spaces that are not easily defined in relation to kind of classic representations of cities and urban spaces. So the 19th century French artist Gustave Caillebotte, who is really best known for depicting the newly modernized boulevards of Haussmann's Paris, he also produced these other interesting depictions of Paris over the rooftops, sort of random views from, and also on the edge of the city. So here we see a kind of deceptively naturalistic scene which really belies the impending impact of urbanization towards the edge of the city. And water, I think, also plays an ambivalent role in this scene because it's an object of aesthetic contemplation. It's also part of the hydrological dynamics of the city itself, but it also had important economic uses and functions as well within the industrializing metropolis. Another artist who I think is interesting as well is the realist, German realist artist Adolf Menzel. His depiction of Berlin here, a rear courtyard and house, and there's a lone water pump here with sort of heavily trampled ground around it. But and you can see also the on the horizon the sort of steady advance of Berlin in its sort of rapid phase of growth. But this everyday scene, nonetheless, I think, connects with an impoverished collective city, the tenements, which had no access to ready access to water and so on. This other city, if you like, lying behind the Wilhelmine facades and the more familiar representations of Berlin. And to some degree, Caillebotte and Menzel were developing their realist approaches to art in parallel with the early emergence of photography. And it's interesting, I think, to counterpose these different modes of visual representation in relation to the 19th century city. Also, I think in literature, there are many rich possibilities to discover not only spaces and places, sounds and smells captured in literature, but even the subtle cadence of human conversation as well. And I think Zola is endlessly fascinating. So Zola at L'Assommoir from 1877, and this is really regarded as one of the finest representations of working class life in Paris. And among one of the scenes in this book is the visit by the main female character to a communal laundry in 19th century Paris, described as a constant rush of water from the faucets, a great splashing as the clothes were rinsed, accompanied by the pounding and banging of the beaters, and then the constant steam engine also in the background. And this extremely noisy, intense scene of the communal laundry is in a way not unlike contemporary scenes we might find in Mumbai, for example, the Dhobi Ghat, the vast open-air wash space and so on. So these communal wash spaces then vividly evoked in 19th century Paris, but have not actually disappeared. And interestingly, this novel was roundly condemned in its day by conservative critics. But literature can also, I think, explore some of the anomalies or tensions in relation to urban change. And science fiction literature can also be fascinating in this respect. The novelist J.G. Ballard has investigated quite extensively what he termed the near future, involving themes such as societal collapse, infrastructure failure, and fantastical combinations of the body and technology. But in fact, one of his recurring motifs is the abandoned swimming pool. This is the Uxbridge Lido in London, photographed, I think, only about 2 or 3 years ago. For Ballard, though, the abandoned swimming pool was something fascinating in a sense that it was the exposed anatomy of modernity, which he variously imagined as a place of violence with easily cleaned tiles, a psychic zero station, or in some cases he described entire landscapes as drained concrete pits like votive offerings. So it really kind of fired his literary imagination, these abandoned spaces. In terms of more recent photography, Baird and Hiller Becker really stand out, I think, in relation to infrastructure installations. And some of you will be familiar with their typologies around grain silos, coking ovens, or water towers. And these, I think, are extremely interesting because the repetitive of the image sequences. There are dozens of photographs that they put together in these panels and also in the books that they published. The repetitiveness of the image sequences, I think, bears an echo of Fordist mass production and the historical era that gave rise to these industrial landscapes. And additionally, the Becker's fascination with these industrial landscapes of the Ruhr and Pennsylvania and other regions really coincides with the precise moment of their dissolution or partial reconfiguration, because their work really spans the period from the mid-60s up to the middle or late 1980s with these projects. I also think it's extremely interesting that although at one level these objects seem to display a uniformity or standardization, which I referred to earlier. Yet when you look at these forms gathered together, they're almost like snowflakes with their sort of extraordinary individual differences. So even at a moment of complete standardization, ostensibly, we're nonetheless left with a bizarre variety and assortment of potential designs or structures. Now, an interest in the, if you like, the mystery or an interest in the mystery or scale of infrastructure installations is also to be found in the work of Jane and Louise Wilson. So this is the South Corridor inside Hoover Dam, photographed in 1999. And for me, these deserted internal corridors with their smooth surfaces and functional lighting curving into infinity evoke a sense of disorientation within the space and time of modernity, in the sense of where are we, what are these spaces for, and why is there no one here? They're sort of extremely fascinating images, I think. And perhaps moving from ground to air, we can consider the vertiginous waterscapes of Edward Butynsky, whose work will be already familiar to you from the cover of Neil Brenner's book on planetary urbanization, the tar sands landscape. Butynsky's most recent project is on water landscapes, and this is the edge of Phoenix, Arizona, and it's kind of remarkable how the presence or absence of water serves as an absolute spatial delineator in images such as this. And I think, however, these panoramic or cinematic depictions of landscapes and also landscapes of environmental destruction or degradation also pose a difficulty in terms of their analytical parameters, because the structural relationships between different elements in the landscape remain obscure. How these spaces were actually produced, they're presented to us in a somewhat mysterious or dematerialized way. And also in Butynsky's work, almost invariably, the human figure is absent. These are deserted or absent landscapes. The human figure is vestigial or absent. And it reminds me of some of the photographs of Rust Belt cities such as Detroit, where there's, if you like, an aestheticization of infrastructure collapse or urban decay, within which the human figure is very often absent or purely incidental, as if the city itself had been completely deserted, which is, of course, not true. So, to conclude then, how do these imaginative engagements with urban technology relate to public culture? Different modes of representation can unearth ironic or unexpected elements that might otherwise remain hidden. A difficulty, however, is how disparate realms of individual creativity can be reconciled with public discourse or more sustained forms of social or political dialogue. And here I think the tensions, philosophical tensions between Jürgen Habermas and Richard Rorty are to me very, very interesting, because often in some of these philosophical debates, bodies of work or concepts tend to speak past each other or cling to some element of incrementability. But the dialogues around their work is very fascinating, I think, in terms of the relationship between knowledge and public culture. And Habermas's work is, however, marked by an absence of technology, or in Andrew Feinberg's words, a blissful indifference towards technology. So concerned is he to separate, if you like, the technical realm from the life world or the hermeneutic realm, that technology appears to play virtually no role within his social theory. Equally, Richard Rorty, who really sees knowledge essentially as a process of metaphorical redescription, and essentially prefers to leave technical matters to technical realms of knowledge, in his own words, a matter for the engineers, Rorty is concerned not to worry about forcibly bringing together, if you like, the public realm, the practical realm of public policy, and the private realm of irony and creative imagination. He doesn't think that we should try to force these different elements together into one kind of analytical framework. But I'm rather worried by this. I'm worried by both Habermas and Rorty in terms of how they try to reconcile these different strands of private and public, and also technology and the public sphere. And I would simply suggest then that different worlds originate within the human imagination before their concrete realization, whether a poem, an engineering solution, or a designed landscape. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Matthew. We've got about 10 to 15 minutes for questions. I'll kick off if no one else is going to kick off, but I'll also come back to questions. I mean, just an immediate reaction, apart from being a fantastic journey through extraordinary landscapes in the plural. I think I heard you say that these ecologies are necessarily cosmopolitan ecologies. And I just wondered about that for a second. On the case of the Thames Barrier, there are some odd paradoxes, I guess, that you mentioned that it's 30 years to build, and I think, for my sins, I was chair of something called the Thames Gateway Partnership for 7 years, so I'm part of that vision that you described, and I bear the sins and scars, but part of the sins and scars, so these were partly paradoxical. So to be fair to the Boris Island Airport, which I'm not particularly inclined towards, but that part of that project is about building a new barrack, partly because the people are saying it took 30 years to build the last one, and if you look forward 30 years, we should have already started designing either the extension or the build on. But there's another lobby, which there's some quite interesting work done in the Gateway that suggests that some of your other landscape might involve flooding, constructive flooding. And if you look at Hamburg, what's happening in Hamburg right now, people are building the new Docklands in Hamburg to be flooded, assuming it will be flooded. And so you build resilience. So I suppose that raises the question about how we think about the politics of ecology in different ways, but in the context of something very specific, like what happens in London with the politics of water, it seems it's more a politics of sovereignty than a politics of the cosmopolitan, because if one thinks about the challenges, do we have more airport space and a new barrier, paradoxically, what the ecology of that is, or do we flood some of those landscapes in Essex you were talking about constructively, a la Hamburg, in a way, that creates a slightly different debate rather than just a cosmopolitan one. But that's an opening question. If anyone else wants to come in, I was just...
Shall I just come back quickly on those points that I got them in my head? Okay. Should I switch this on? Does it work? I don't know. Is that... No. You mentioned... cosmopolitan ecologies. Maybe I should just clarify my use of that term. Mm. I'm kind of wearing my biodiversity hat using that term, right, in the sense that urban space is typically characterized by global assemblages of species, and that's why, in terms of spontaneous assemblages of nature, plants, and so on. So that's why the cosmopolitan ecology is a useful term in that respect. Yeah. But it also, as I was trying to suggest, it complicates this notion of ecological restoration, because what is the originary landscape which is being recreated design terms? So in London, we know that in the Roman era, there were plants from North Africa already established within what's now the metropolitan space of London. So how far back are we going, and what kind of image is being projected in some of these ecological reconstructions? And I think your other point, though, about the future of London in a very profound way to the east, mm, in terms of what to do after the Thames Barrier has reached the end of its life, what will happen after that. One of the interesting things to me is how will different pathways be identified or introduced into public discourse? Because if you recall the diagram from the inside of the Thames Barrier, the extraordinarily complex technical debates in relation to infrastructure, and something that I've always been struck by in relation to the politics of technology, and in fact environmental politics more generally, is How do you enable a space for highly complex, often esoteric debates to be adequately discussed or deliberated within a public sphere? Mm. And another quick example I'd give from work I did many years ago on waste management was that you get a very superficial sense of public interest in, let's say, recycling, but in fact, waste as a topic is extraordinarily complex in every conceivable way. And how do you introduce that into a kind of a deliberative public discourse is very difficult to do, I think.
Super sewer in London, isn't it? But anyway,
yeah.
I've got some people now. One and two and three. So we'll take three and then see it. Roger.
Yeah, fascinating. Thank you. Great. And I just have a very simple question. Just to pick three examples: Lagos, Nigeria; Phoenix, Arizona; and Berlin, Germany. Are they on a continuum of global urbanism, or are they entirely divergent examples of urban political ecologies?
Okay, can you take it through? I think the second here, and the third was... Actually, if you bear with us, otherwise we'll have to run three times up and down. So we'll do two and then three.
I have a very mundane question, followed by something which is probably less mundane. The first one is a question about real estate. What is exceptionally important, and does put the values up in real estate? My follow-up comment is on psychiatry. Is the use of water by the Ottomans, for example, in Vietnam, to therapeutic purposes for the mad people. Also, in engineering aspects, is the use of water in the famous Tennessee River Valley Authority, something that Dame Sylvia Crowe has written in a famous book back in the 50s called The Landscape of Power. In terms of music, water, sculpture, and architecture is embodied in the work of Albinoni on the fountains, I think, of Rome, who's a very, very beautiful subject. In the history of art, it's Vincent Scully who wrote beautifully, a professor at Yale, about the dematerialization of water. I can go on and on because water is such an extraordinary subject, but I think probably the mundane question first, how important it is in real estate. Thank you.
Okay, and then one. Are you okay to take the three?
I'll do three. Yeah.
Hello. It was just an anecdote, actually, about the esoteric debate, and it relates to the Thames Barrier. And also, I suppose, it relates to the value of real estate as well. I think at the time the Thames Barrier was being discussed, the Treasury had a test discount rate of 8%. And when you apply that sort of a test discount rate, it means that long-term costs and benefits are reduced to very low values indeed. And as I understand it, the Thames Barrier was not stacking up under those conditions. Apparently, the promoters of the project showed the Treasury a map of London with a contour line drawn at the flood surge level. And they produced a valuation of all the property within it, added it up, presented that to the Treasury, and on the basis of that, the project was approved. However, in an actual
sounds just
flood,
like the Olympic Games bid. Sounds just like the Olympic Games bid.
I wouldn't mind to comment on the Olympic Games bid. I mean, the reality is the actual potential area that floods is profoundly less. It takes a long time to flood a complete area. So I suppose it's back to this theme of language and communication and deceit. A deceit was practiced on the Treasury and a Thames flood barrier resulted.
For the public good, possibly.
The property prices were accurate. The flood risk area was grossly overstated.
Right. Okay, Matthew.
Just to come back quickly. Roger's question, Lagos, Phoenix, Berlin. I think it's a very interesting question, and I think really they're both. They're becoming more alike and more different. And I think this perhaps is one of the core analytical challenges at the moment, is to make sense of these simultaneous processes that are pulling things in different directions, to answer your question. Yes, I mean, a whole range of observations about water. I mean, the Thames Valley, the Tennessee Valley Authority, and the 1920s are really a pivotal moment because the word infrastructure actually emerges from this precise historical moment and the control of a flooding in the New Deal era. So these things are inextricably related, politically, historically, terminologically, linked together. And you mentioned, if I understood it right, you mentioned something about the relationship between water and real estate. And there's no question in relation to contemporary urbanization that the waterfront or waterside developments have been extremely significant in the post-industrial metropolis, linking across with these other related discourses of ecological gentrification and so on. And there are many, many examples we can draw on to illustrate that. And then just finally, this question about the sort of technical deliberation that went before the creation of the Thames barrier. There's a report called the Bondi Report from 1967, which is really interesting. It was commissioned to be carried out by Professor of Mathematics at Queen Mary College in London, Sir Herman Bondi. And so they didn't bring in an engineer, they brought in a mathematician, and he prepared this report, which, in a similar to what you're suggesting there, he tried to offer some sense of the impact of a major flood event in London as a kind of jolt, if you like, to civil servants. But there again, I mean, the time gap, if you like, between the original incident in 1952, rather, and then the 1953, and then the construction, the opening of the barrier in 1982 and its first use, is very interesting to me, this very long time lag between catastrophic events and then the major public policy infrastructure response.
Okay, we're going to go one, two, and then three, so again to...
Thank you, it's fascinating. I just wanted to pick up on the, hear your thoughts on the issue of representation. And then this is from the kind of challenges that water shows up for my own understanding of it. Water is seen very much as a part of well-being, good health, a spread of disease, and so on and so forth. And if then water is represented in that way, does it detract from its other uses? I think your livelihoods of the poor will depend a lot on water, whether you're washing clothes, you're cooking, you're running a business. And often, I think, in the kind of discourses in urban policy, the local south to water, that seems to kind of disappear or become very, very opaque in the whole discussions around water provision. So, for example, where you locate people is about public health, rather than what water does in their own life. I just want your thoughts on that.
Okay. And then okay. Just behind you, if you could pass the microphone straight back.
Yes, thank you. I have actually two questions, I guess. One might be very simple, and one is...
Does somebody have a pen? Sorry, quickly. My pen's run out. It sounds like you've got two very complicated questions coming. Thank you.
Just correct me if I misheard you or if I heard you correctly, whether or not you suggested that technocratic assurance was a period that was previous and not necessarily now. I think this is in your second year periodicity talk. And so maybe you can say a little something about that. But also this project you're looking, in which you're looking at the LA River, I find it interesting. It's a highly complex river to pick a river. Specifically in California, it sounds like you're engaging with the issue of native and indigenous plants and all of those kinds of politics and cultural assumptions that come along with those kinds of things. But particularly in, I think, an urban context with nature in a city that's been fighting in contested landscapes for a long time, race is such a critical thing in the U.S. So I'm wondering how much you're engaging with racial politics within the city and how that relates to nature, being that this is a very big debate right now, people of color and their relationships to nature in the U.S. and the relationships to conservation, restoration, and et cetera, et cetera.
Okay, I'm just at the back.
Okay. I can shout.
I don't know whether it goes on
there. No, we'll go the way around. I'll shout. Potentially.
You hold on one second.
Probably they say, potentially a trivial, potentially massive question, but just a comment maybe because you raised it.
how much is water different, or how is, if it is, water different from waste as an object of inquiry?
Okay. Shall I take those? Yeah. I get confused on that. In terms of water and everyday lives of the poor, and maybe the loss of focus on some of these questions, I think that one of the most profound things that strikes me is that if we're talking about technology, is that the science and technology of providing safe drinking water is not mysterious. So it's not fundamentally, it's nothing to do with technology, the issue of why 1 billion or 2 billion people have inadequate access. It's fundamentally a question of politics. And in the Indian context, without which I know a little, one of the dynamics that's very clear to me is this, under contemporary urbanization, this growing middle class disdain for the poor. So we have this kind of bourgeois environmentalism which seeks to exclude or eliminate or hide the poor, who are nevertheless essential for the economic functioning of these cities, and that whereas in previous periods there'd been fundamentally different approaches to the incorporation of informal settlements within the fabric of the city in terms of land rights and things like that, now the discourse is shifted towards this sort of urban boosterist, which I'm sure you're familiar with, the sort of a very different set of discourses about what denotes a green city. And when we talk about the greening of cities, we have to be very careful about what this discourse means in different contexts in relation to the actually existing fabric of the city and life in the cities that we're talking about. So I think that maybe partially answers the dilemma you
raised. In fact, also that India doesn't have, for example, a national water policy.
Right.
Fragmented by state conflict. So you can have one state in a drought situation and another state which is being flooded because of rains. You know? So there's no kind of how that water is distributed, even if it's for just purely health grants.
Mm. And then the next question, two, in some ways, quite different points. This notion about sort of technocratic governmentality and the particular moments when this becomes most powerful. I think if we were to have a historical periodization of the technological politics of water, one of the key moments, I think, is it's not specifically water, but in terms of the mindset, is Abel Wolman's article from 1965 on the metabolism of cities. And I think that the 60s marks the kind of the high point of confidence that engineers could shape space at will through sort of technological means and plans. And of course, it links in terms of medical discourse and the elimination of malaria that I also mentioned earlier in the lecture. A certain confidence then in the power of science and technology and a particular type of expert to solve problems, possibly linking with there's the Gore Vidal quip that there's no human problem could not be solved if people would simply do what I told them to do. So there's that sort of sense of a confidence just to tell people how things should be done. And then, of course, in the LA context, a very, very complex interrelationship between urban politics and the environment, and that there's almost a counter discourse to the ecological restoration through the environmental justice movement, the Mothers of East Los Angeles, and the predominantly Latino communities to the east, and their conceptualization of how the concrete drainage channels present a threat is very different to the more wealthy communities, in the sense of the way that the concrete drainage channels can, in a sense, be a magnet to unwanted land uses that become heavily concentrated in their neighbourhoods. So it's a kind of a circularity behind certain previous conceptions of different spaces within the city, rather than, if you like, a narrow aesthetic discourse about greening the river channels, the more profound issues at stake. And also, I think it's worth pointing out that the concrete landscapes of Los Angeles have been an important part of urban culture, that artists, poets, there's a counter discourse to the ecological argument, which has been I think, significantly disregarded. So it's a highly complex set of developments, but you're very right, I think, to highlight the need to emphasize that. And then Michaela's point about water and waste. I think that one of the intriguing things about the urban political ecology approach, as it emerged from the 1990s, particularly through the work of Eric Swingerdow and others, is that, okay, water was one strand, and probably the strand that had been most explored within that body of work, but we also find, of course, fascinating work on lawns, food. I had a doctoral student who looked at the political ecology of air in Manhattan, so there are other aspects to the material environment that can be usefully explored using that approach, I think. And so your core point was whether water or waste, which was more complex, is that right? Or
more if they are actually going to be different. I'm assuming that from that perspective they're actually quite the same. You could even pick energy at that point.
I think from an analytical point of view, there are certain parallels which are interesting. If only because if you talk about if you explore the history of urbanization, that these kinds of questions were often treated in an interrelated way and showed certain parallels, I think.
Okay. Matthew, thank you very much for the